Hey, good morning, Hillside family. How are you doing this morning? Really? Okay, there we go. It's like, ooh. So we're glad to see you guys here this morning with us. We just have a couple of announcements before we get into the service today. And so small groups. The men's and women's groups meet here at the church every other Monday at 6:30. Tomorrow we'll be meeting here. So if you haven't come out, then come and check us out. It's a pretty cool thing that we can get together and, you know, fuss at the men when they get too loud or, you know.
It's a rowdy bunch.
I know, right? It's a lot of fun, so you need to come and see what it's all about. So we'd love to see you here. All right, so Community Elementary, we have a volunteer opportunity for outreach for you guys. Back when, a couple years ago, we actually had done this before, but Community Elementary is one of the schools that we've helped support over the years. What this is it's a family night where they're trying to get parents to come out and get involved. And so they're doing an event with the Adventure Science Center. They're gonna have like lots of STEM projects set up. And what we can do is we're gonna provide the pizza, we're gonna provide water and like dessert snack cakes. So we need folks to come out and help us serve the community and come in and interact and talk to folks about us. And, you know, it's a really great time. So it's gonna be Tuesday, May the 10th. I'm gonna say 5 o'clock for now because we're gonna need people to help set up. We're gonna meet at the school, but come on anytime after that and come serve with us. Represent your Hillside t-shirt. If you don't have one of those already, let us know and we'll get you hooked up. So that's really exciting. So the next thing is the Hillside Reading Plan, reading through the New Testament together as a church. This week we'll be doing Luke 10 through 13. So come on in, join us with that too. Prayer and worship gathering. It's going to be Friday at 6:30. Guys, have you ever wondered if you are within God's will? Every person was born for prayer and worship. So anytime you're in prayer worshiping, you are fulfilling your purpose in life. I want you to come out and pray and worship with us. It's an honor, and it's to be in a room full of believers that everybody, we can exalt the name of Jesus together, and it's going to be a wonderful night. So we really want to see you faces out here to pray and worship with us, okay? And giving. We have our tithing stations, the tithing boxes are on the communion stations. We have the app, the Faith Life app, and then we have the website, which is hillsidechurchtn.org. All right, so thank you guys. If you would, just pray with me, and we'll get started into prayer and worship. Father God, thank you for this day. Every single person that has made it in today. And for those that can't be with us, I pray that you are with them, that you protect them. If they are feeling ill, God, that you would heal their bodies. God, again, it's just an honor to be able to be in your house and to speak to you, to worship you, and to get to know you.
We Good morning, church. You thought you could get away from Acts, but we are back. It was really interesting. I saw a one-year anniversary when we were putting all this together. We have literally, I think come May, the beginning of May, we will have been in Acts for a year. Yeah. Man, that's rude. Hey, and I'll be honest, I have loved every bit of it. I have learned so much. Even half the stuff I don't even get to teach, I have learned so much going through Acts at this pace. I want to talk about something real quick, and then we're going to get into the lesson, and you guys will be happy. I'm doing 32 whole verses today. We are speeding up to the end, but we're going to get there. So Friday, Sandra mentioned this, we're going to have our first prayer and worship gathering of 2022. And I want you to hear my heart in this. Myself and a number of you here, most of you are either concerned or you're broken because of the state of the church, capital C today. And we're concerned because of the extent of scandals, worldly ideas creeping into the church, and what seems to be the absence of the gospel, or at least the mitigating of the gospel. And after our prayer and worship gathering on Friday, we're going to take the next 2 months and we are going to focus on prayer, praying for the church, capital C, and praying for each other. We are also going to focus on worship. What does it mean to worship? And here the difference here. There's a difference between talking about what it means to worship and what it means to live as a worshiper. And we're going to get into that big time. And I think we need to. So when we finish Acts, I'm going to teach a four-week series on biblical worship and what it means. And I think this is going to be so critical for us, especially at where we've been and where we're going. And my ask of you is this. Here's what I ask you today. Will you focus with us? If you can be here Friday to pray and to worship, that's great. We're going to have childcare for the first time. We're going to take care of your kids. We're going to have snacks. You don't have to get babysitters or stay home because of that. It's a Friday night. We'd love for you to come. But the ask is this, will you pray with us for God's church, for His bride? Will you set aside some time, even if it's 5 or 10 minutes a day? And for worship, to kind of give you an example, what we're going to be doing is Melissa and Michelle are putting together some worship playlists so that when you drive into work, it's almost as long as the time you'll be in your car, unless you drive an hour to work. Then we need to talk. I'd love for you to get closer, but I know how hard that is. But most people drive about 30 to 40 minutes in their car. There's going to be playlists with different songs in them that you can listen and worship God. And here's my thing. At the end of the day, if as a church, if all I do is Sunday services and Monday through Saturday I live the way that I just want to live, am I honoring God with my life? And so we're trying to give you every opportunity that we can. The reason why we're reading through the Bible together, the reason why we'll go through this season together in prayer and worship over the next 2 months is because coming to church and being a part of church should take you somewhere. It should drive your Christian, it should be a point of your Christian life where the Spirit is present and He moves in all of us as we choose to pursue Him together. And my question is will you do this with me? Will you do this with me? So find that 5 minutes a day. Find that 10 minutes a day. We're going to put things on social media to kind of point in directions of who to pray for and what we're praying together as a church. I think there's power in Scripture when the church prays together. Okay? So that's my heart as far as what's going to happen from next Friday, probably through the end of June. Is that we would pray, that we would worship, we would understand what it means to be a worshiper. Amen? Okay. So, we got a lot of ground to cover today, so if you have your Bibles, Go to the book of Acts, chapter 26, okay? So in Acts chapter 26, I want you to think of this as we're turning there. As we face the world, there are questions of the Christian faith that believers either don't know how to answer or they just run from. Let me give you an example. Why does God allow evil? Why does God allow poverty or cancer? Why do bad things happen to good people? And why did God create hell? And what happens is there's many more questions just like these. If someone were to ask you those questions, most people go, you should talk to my pastor. And I do my best. It's almost like playing goalie. Here they come, right? They get past the offense. They get to the goalie. But most of them won't come to me. They want to hear it from you. They don't know me. They know you. And Paul is our example today. And in his trial, he answers one of what I would call these difficult questions. And by the way, if you don't know the answer to these questions, you want to know them, please come see me after service. I will at least give you my answer from what I see from Scripture. But in all this being said, Paul's given a hard question today in his defense. And this is the question that's been posed to him. How do you know God exists? And more specifically for Paul, how does he know Jesus? How does he know if Jesus is God? How does he know this? And so they don't directly ask him the question, but in the trial, Paul's defense is going to answer this question in what I think is a very thorough way. And sometimes what happens is because we don't think about our witness, our answers often fall short. Someone asks you about God, or why do you think God exists? And we say things like, well, I just know he's there. There's got to be more than this. And God's answered my prayers, and I feel his presence. And those are great things for the believer. But for someone who doesn't trust your experience, it's not a complete answer for them. They question it, and then they question you. So before we get into the text, there's three ways that I want you to understand how Paul is a witness for Jesus Christ. And if we can hold on to these things, this will impact our witness as well. That if we're going to dig into these things and know how to answer these three categories well that we see in Scripture, I believe you will be a good witness for Jesus through these three categories. So what we see in Paul is this, is first and foremost, when they ask him, he answers rationally. Paul appeals to the court that that they're still alive. These are the people that were alive when Jesus rose from the grave. He appeals to the court that the tomb was empty and they saw it. He's trying to be rational with them. And you'll see this in our text, that his answer was verifiable. And he reasoned with them that Jesus is alive. And today, even today, we can talk about the rational existence of Jesus. We can talk about how the Romans and Jews never produced the body of a dead Messiah. We can talk from apologetics as to how science can explain things like love, like sacrifice. And we know more about creation and reasoning today. We have more evidence from archaeology that verify truths, historical truths from the Bible. We can answer rationally. But sometimes we don't go into this and we don't understand this, so we don't know how to share a rational belief in Jesus. But then secondly, Paul actually answers experientially. He explains his personal experience with the risen Jesus. He gives his testimony to them. This is when we do share our testimony today, that we can sit down with someone one-on-one and explain, why does David follow Christ? Why does Ty follow Christ? Why does Ben follow Jesus? There's an experience that happened. And this is what happens when we share our testimony. And believers, basically for us, it's the text applied to our lives. And it's interesting because when we grow up, we called it witnessing when we would go out, but we never imagined that we were supposed to live as witnesses. I was in church, gosh, before many of you were born. Most of you are my age, but a few of you before you were born. And we always knocked door to door and witnessing. And I was like, why are we going out witnessing? And here I'm this little kid handing tracts out. But I was never told that I was a witness. I was never told. We are witnesses. People want to hear the emotional side of our faith. People want to hear the rational side of it. But all of this together, it can't be one or the other. It can't be a heartless faith, and it can't be a facts faith. Facts and faith are actually separate from each other. Sometimes there's faith in what you can't see. Facts will only get you so far. And then finally, what we're going to see at the end of this is that Paul answers biblically. Biblically. Paul never saw Christianity as a division of Judaism, but a completion of it. Paul, throughout Acts, he reasons from the Old Testament that Jesus is the summation of all the law and prophets. And for someone outside of the faith, it's usually not until they hear your story, that they hear your reasons, that you then can talk to them about the Bible. Let's talk about what the Bible says. Now, often if you try to use the Bible as an authority in conversation for someone who doesn't believe, unfortunately, the Bible is not their authority, even though it's yours. So they have to see all of this from you. And Paul does this very well in the chapter today. And it's usually when they see Paul, when they look at the facts, then they see his experience. Well, let's look at what Scripture says. They'll listen. They must first see the truth of God's Word in your life before they will see God's Word for theirs. I want to say this one more time. They must first see the truth of God's Word in your life before they will want God's Word for theirs. And it's important because what does that mean? It's not just what you read that matters. How you live matters. How you live when life gets difficult. What do you turn to when life is easy? And after verifying this life of a witness, that people then want to know and need to know the content of a witness. Scripture. Do we know what the Bible says about Jesus? I think one of the hardest things today is when we talk to people about Jesus, like in the workplace or our family, and they ask us about Scripture and we don't know it. What do you think the message is that we send? What's the message? You want me to be committed to your faith, but you're not committed to it. Isn't that the message? It's a scary place to be. It's a scary witness to be. So, do we know what the Bible says about Jesus? Can we articulate it to others? Can we share prophecies and teachings? Can we share the gospel? The challenge of Paul and his testimony today for all of us begins with this searing question. What kind of witness are you? Do you even care about being a witness? Does that matter to you? Or, oh gosh, Dave's talking about that today? Man. What kind of witness are you, and does it matter? Are you passionate about being a witness? Do we have the rational answer? Can we testify about Jesus through our experience, through our testimony? Do we know the Scriptures well enough that others can see Jesus in us because we know His Word? Do they know this? And if we can, through Christ, we can offer hope. We can tell them about what real healing is, what eternal life is. We can show the world a better way. And my fear is this, is that there are missed opportunities because we have not taken our witness seriously. When's the last time you thought about your witness for Jesus and what kind of witness are you? When's the last time you had that thought process in your head? I'll be honest, we don't typically have that thought process. We've seen being a witness as a mandate of the church or some crazy pastor in the middle of Rockvale. rather than obedience to God. We're supposed to do this not because Dave wants you to be a witness, but because Jesus has called all of us to be witnesses. And we would be remiss today, as Paul testifies again to the power of the gospel, if we didn't consider our own witness. What kind of witness for Jesus are we? We should be able to articulate Jesus rationally, experientially, and biblically to anyone Jesus would bring across our path. I love what Peter says here. He says this. He says, "But in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect." The other thing is this. When I understand that I am a witness, and I go through the steps that it takes to be a stronger witness, what does that do to my heart? What does that do to my life? I'll tell you my story really quick, and I know his life did not end well, but I started to take apologetics very seriously in my life for a while. And I would listen to Ravi Zacharias, and he would point me to Scripture, and I would do Bible studies. And there's something that changed in my heart when I decided to be a witness. I had a confidence that I didn't have before. There are questions that I had that I had answered for me. Why does God allow evil? There's a really good answer for that. Why do all these things happen? Man, being a witness, I felt like the Grinch, that my heart had grown like 3 sizes that day. Because all of a sudden, when I had full realization of the promises of God for my own life, and full realization of how to articulate that to someone else, my faith grew. I promise you, we're not going to start a witnessing team and go around Rockvale and have a formal church ministry. I think we're all called to witness where we're at. We're all called to witness where we're at. But I will tell you this, that step in my life grew my heart. This is more than some religious mandate. It will change you. It will change you. So Paul's reminder today is that our witness matters. So with that, we got a lot of reading today, but we're going to take the first 11 verses, and if you'll stay with me, we're going to make it, I promise. Verse 1 through 11. This is verse 1. So Agrippa said to Paul, "You have permission to speak for yourself." Then Paul stretched out his hand and made his defense. "I consider myself fortunate that this is before you, King Agrippa. I am going to make my defense today against all the accusations of the Jews, especially because you are familiar with all the customs and controversies of the Jews. Therefore, I beg you to listen to me patiently. My manner of life from my youth, spent from the beginning among my own nation and in Jerusalem, is known by all the Jews. They have known for a long time, if they are willing to testify, that according to the strictest party of our religion, I have lived as a Pharisee. And now I stand here on trial because of my hope and the promise made by God to our fathers, to which our 12 tribes hope to attain as they earnestly worship night and day. And for this hope, I am accused by Jews, O King." Verse 8, "Why is it thought incredible by any of you that God raises the dead? I myself was convinced that I ought to do many things in opposing the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And I did so in Jerusalem. I not only locked up many of the saints in prison after receiving authority from the chief priest, but when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. And I punished them often in all the synagogues, and tried to make them blaspheme. And in raging fury against them, I persecuted them even to foreign cities." So let's stop there. So this initial moment, I want you to look at the picture of this moment for a second. So here's Paul on trial. He's on trial for his faith. It's almost a sermon in itself because he's in chains. And what it says Paul stretches out his hands. Imagine a man in chains, stretching out his hands to share the gospel. And you hear the chains rattle. Imagine this imagery, raising his arms, the noise of the chains, the imagery of the price that Paul is actually willing to pay for the gospel. He is this living example that the gospel is worth the chains that he is holding on to. And despite what's been taught, the gospel never promises you an easy life. When we look at Scripture, it never promises you an easy life or a pain-free life or an unchallenged life on this earth. The gospel promised you Jesus, his atonement, his message, his truth. So the man in chains lifts up his hands, holding nothing but Jesus. Lord, may we learn Paul's message here, just as before he says a word. And this is Paul's fifth defense, if you've been paying attention. Starting in Acts 22, all the way through 26, it contains all five defenses that Paul gives for his faith. But if you were to ask Paul, he would say, here are five opportunities I had to share the gospel. Five opportunities to share the gospel. So he sits in jail because of the gospel for 2 years between Felix and Festus. And Paul is a man in chains, but Jesus is worth it. And even though he is a man in chains, he is more free than anybody else in the room. And so as Paul begins to talk about the type of Pharisee he was, Paul's life is told from the context of his past. What's rather interesting is that Paul may have grown up with some of these men accusing them. So here they are, they're accusing him, and they're like, I know that guy. He was the Pharisee of Pharisees. He was the really religious amongst all of us. And these men probably would have known or heard of him. They could have easily verified that Paul was once one of them if they weren't sure. And first and foremost here, to be a witness, we must first be able to be honest about our past, about who we once were. We've got to be able to tell the truth of what we did without Jesus. Paul's giving his entire life without Christ. I was a Pharisee. I grew up amongst you. I used to be just like you. Then he says, but Jesus. Paul may sound like he's boasting here and saying he's a Pharisee of Pharisees, but he's not. What Paul's really saying here is said, of all the Pharisees, I was Pharisaical Pharisee Paul. And if Jesus can change me, he can change you. And it's why he calls himself the Pharisee of Pharisees. There's no extent of how far they could have gone in their religion that Christ could not have redeemed them. And Paul knows it. Listen to Paul's opinion of his past. This is actually in Philippians. Philippians 3, 8 through 10 says, indeed, this is Paul talking, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ. The righteousness from God that depends on faith. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. What a statement of Paul's past and his present. Paul recounts this Pharisee of Pharisees' time in his life. He says they're rubbish. I looked up the Greek for rubbish. Do you know what it means? I can't even say it in church. It's a rag that's used for human excrement. Maybe the best way to say it and be nice is, I count my past as poop. I know. It loses the effect, right? But that's what he says. My life is garbage. Without Jesus, no matter how pharisaical I was, Paul's saying it's rubbish. It's garbage. It's poop. I don't want it. Keep it away from me. I just want Jesus. You see, we can look at Paul and see the fruit of his decision. Paul's lesson to us is that he sets aside all of his religious efforts and he declares that he just wants to know Christ and know his resurrection. Paul is not worried about the quality of his life or his piety or how much he has sacrificed. He's only worried about what Christ has sacrificed. So see what happened here. Paul went from working for salvation to knowing that he's saved. He went from attempting to earn it to knowing that Jesus freely gave it. And it's the message for us. Paul looks at all the religious people staring back at him in judgment. And he's basically saying to them, I want you to know Jesus. I want you to know Jesus. I want you to follow him. I want you to believe in his resurrection. And everything that we're trying to protect and defend, all these things that the Pharisees were trying to protect and defend, it was garbage compared to knowing Christ. And Paul then asks them, why is it so difficult for them to believe in the resurrection? They were there. They know the word. Why is this so hard for the Jewish people to understand? And as I said earlier, Christianity is the fulfillment of the law of the Old Testament. These Jewish people should be like Paul, not opposing him. I want you to look at the Old Testament for one second and look at it in the context of the gospel. Let's go through this really quick. In Genesis, when sin enters the world, God foretells to Satan of man's rescuer that he will strike your head and you will strike his heel. In Deuteronomy, Moses misses the promised land because of his sin, but declares that God will raise up another prophet from among them who speaks God's word. In 2 Samuel, King David is promised to have someone from his family on the throne forever as king. Jeremiah promises that God will make a new covenant with his people since they had failed to meet the commitment of the current covenant and that it would be different and that God would place his law on their hearts. Then Daniel, he speaks of a resurrection and that many will rise to eternal life. But because Israel had failed the law, most would not experience that life unless God did something to bring grace. That's all the Old Testament. The prophets speak of a coming Messiah that would be wounded and crushed for us, and by his wounds would bring us healing. All Old Testament, and Paul looks at all the religious leaders and says, why can't you see what I see? Why can't you see? None of these Old Testament ideas find their completion without Jesus. So Paul looks at the Pharisees in this moment of confrontation and he says, why is this so hard? Because I can look at the Old Testament and see Jesus throughout it. And for us, your Bible from beginning to end points to Jesus. This book that you hold in your hands with 40 different divinely inspired authors, 66 books, written over a period of roughly 1,500 years, points to and concludes with a single message. Jesus is Lord. From beginning to end, 1,500 years, the conclusion that he is King of Kings, that he is Lord of Lords. Paul probably wanted to shout this from the rooftops of what they were missing. And we should want to shout it from the rooftops. Because that's what witnesses do. And that is what we are. And like Paul, we are all witnesses to what Christ has done for us. Okay? All right, we got some reading here. This will get us to the end of the chapter, believe it or not. Take a drink to get ready for this one. Stay with me. I promise this is worth it. This is Paul now gets into his testimony. Verse 12 says this. In this connection, I journeyed to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priest. At midday, O king, I saw on the way a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, that shone around me and those who journeyed with me. And when we had all fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. And I said, Who are you, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and stand upon your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to appoint you as a servant and witness to the things in which you have seen me and to those in which I will appear to you. Verse 17. Delivering you from your people and from the Gentiles to whom I am sending you, to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sin and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me. Therefore, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared first to those in Damascus, then in Jerusalem and throughout all the region of Judea, and also to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God, performing deeds in keeping with their repentance. For this reason, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. To this day, I have had the help that comes from God. And so I stand here testifying both to small and great, saying nothing but what the prophets and Moses said would come to pass, that the Christ must suffer, and that by being the first to rise from the dead, he would proclaim light both to our people and to the Gentiles. And as he was saying these things in his defense, Festus said with a loud voice, Paul, you are out of your mind. Your great learning is driving you out of your mind. But Paul said, I am not out of my mind, most excellent Festus, but I am speaking true and rational words. For the king knows about these things, and to him I speak boldly. For I am persuaded that none of these things has escaped his notice, for this has not been done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know that you believe. And Agrippa said to Paul, In a short time, would you persuade me to be a Christian? And Paul said, Whether short or long, I would to God that not only you, but also all who hear me this day might become such as I am, except for these chains. Verse 30. Then the king rose, and the governor and Bernice, and those who were sitting with them. And when they had withdrawn, they said to one another, This man is doing nothing to deserve death or imprisonment. And Agrippa said to Festus, This man could have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar. So, wow. So Paul continues. He's sharing his testimony. He's sharing his experience. He's explaining how Christ moved Paul from his past to his present. And this is how Paul went from raging religious person to committed Christian. As a Pharisee, Paul would consider himself enlightened, that he was one of the separate ones, one of the enlightened ones. He thought that he was the one as a Pharisee with the truth, and that as he was going out and arresting Christians and even having them murdered, that he was extinguishing the lie of Christianity. Do you think it's pretty ironic that Jesus blinds and enlightened Paul with light? Do you not see the irony in this? There's a message here. In the end is this, knowledge doesn't make you enlightened. Christ does. Christ does. There are 456 references to light in the ESV, in the New Testament alone. And not all of them, at least over 400, reference to Christ specifically. Over 400 references. I didn't have time to count them, but I know it's over 400. Look, to be enlightened through worldly knowledge is a worldly idea. To be enlightened by Christ is a Bible idea. That's why we need to understand the difference. Man, the Bible's pretty clear on what it thinks about worldly wisdom, right? Let me give you the shortest answer. Paul here, claiming to be wise, they became fools. There's really no around the path. This is foolish. This is foolish. The people with Paul, they see the light. These soldiers that were traveling with him to arrest Christians, they see the light that Paul saw, but they didn't hear the voice. And I think it's incredible because God has a message for Paul alone. And at the very same time, all these people around him are now witnesses as to what happened to Paul. But the message isn't for them. It's for Paul. And Paul tells the council this that's accusing him because these men that were with him are still alive. They could say, if they were honest, yeah, we were there. We saw the light too. It wasn't just Paul. They could verify it. He's not making it up. But they won't verify it. Why? It's simple, right? We have the same problem today. There are plenty of people in the world that know the truth, but there are few who want it. There is a difference. Last week I told you that 66% of Americans believe in the resurrection in a 2020 poll. But I can tell you right now, the landscape of our country would be much different if that truth mattered to 66% of America. Our landscape would look much different if that fact mattered. So see the intricacy of Paul's vision. Those with him see the light, they're witnesses. The message isn't for them. Only Paul hears the voice of Jesus. And Jesus tells Paul, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It's hard for you to kick against the goads." Notice Christ's ownership and Paul's suffering and ours. Not in that moment. It's the suffering of the Christians that Paul is killing. Man, Jesus doesn't say, "Why are you persecuting them?" He says, "Why are you persecuting me?" Paul's killing Christians, and Jesus doesn't look at this as some exterior pain. He looks at it as an internal pain. Church, I believe this is honest and biblical truth. You are not alone when you suffer. You're not alone when you suffer. The shortest verse in the New Testament is Jesus wept. And it was at the death of Lazarus. And he's not even crying over Lazarus's death. He's about to raise him. But Jesus is overwhelmed by the grief of everyone at the funeral, so he weeps. Man, I believe God sees us where we are at, and the picture is one of a loving Savior weeping with us in our despair, weeping with us in our failure. Man, I've had a pretty difficult week, to be honest with you, just to be transparent. I'm always honest, or I try to be. I had a friend in the faith die. But this entire week, and I cried a couple times this week. He was in the first small group I ever led, and he was probably one of the first young men I discipled. And it hurt. I went to the visitation, and it was hard for me to see him there. But not for one moment this week did I think I was hurting alone. I don't think I was hurting alone at all. There are moments in life that will cripple us. And we have got to understand that we are not alone. That is the beauty of the gospel. It's incredibly beautiful when you understand its truths. So Jesus continues, and he informs Paul that Paul's kicking against the goads. All right, guys, Jesus is comparing Paul to a stubborn animal that will not obey. The irony is that Paul, who was a stubborn animal that would not obey, is speaking now at the court to other stubborn animals that will not obey, right? And to be honest, let's go, I hope you'll be honest too. I've been the stubborn animal that will not obey, right? Hopefully I'm not the only stubborn animal that will not obey. The rest of you are so righteous that I don't even know why I'm up here. We are the stubborn animals that don't like to obey. And Paul and Ty just said amen to that. That means so be it. Don't be the stubborn animal that doesn't obey. Paul at the moment, he thought he was obeying God. But he's fighting against him. He's opposing him. So in this moment where Paul is blinded by the light, he's struck down in the road, he stopped immediately. Some scholars wonder if Jesus would have let Paul up if Paul didn't obey. But Paul says, "Yes, Lord." So Paul is permitted to get up. And then Paul goes where God tells him to go. And so when Paul looks at his life and all that he's done to God's people, to the church, it's actually God's mercy that marks Paul's present. If we're looking at this from the standpoint of our past, often what happens is that we think our past sins are so great that we can't be forgiven. Paul says, "You think you're bad? I killed people in the church. I killed people in the church." And in his present, Paul is relying utterly and completely on God's mercy. And this is for every believer. The mercy of God marks every breath of our lives and eternity. When you breathe in, you breathe in grace and you breathe out mercy. That's been given to you by God. We breathe in and we breathe out the mercy of God. And verse 18, if you have your Bibles open, it's pivotal in this passage. It is a picture of the gospel presented by Paul to Agrippa. And there's three things he focuses on here. He said the gospel is for the opening of eyes. The gospel will move someone from darkness to light. The gospel is for the forgiveness of sins. So he's presenting the gospel to Agrippa here. And even Festus, who will not listen. And we'll talk about that in a minute. And the opening of eyes suggests that it's someone asleep, someone dead, someone unaware. Paul wanted the same light that blinded him to move them from the power of Satan to the power of Christ for the forgiveness of sins and to take their place alongside him as witnesses for Jesus. He wanted everyone to experience the same light that he did. And Paul takes the light that blinded him and he wishes it upon them. So in presenting the gospel, Paul is not only trying to change their present, he's also trying to change their future. The most difficult thing to understand in this trial that it's not Paul's freedom at stake. Yes, he's been in prison. Yes, he holds his hands out and he's in chains. But what's happening at this trial today is it's not Paul's future that's at stake. It's set. The whole scene is a dichotomy. That the people who think they're in control and are judging are the ones that are dying, that are going to be lost without Christ. And this scene is seen two ways, from the physical to the spiritual. And Paul is saying, "I want you to see the light that I saw." It's not Paul's freedom at stake. It's their eternity, and Paul knows it. And it's too much for Festus. And he's overwhelmed by the gospel, and he believes Paul to be mad. But there's a problem with Festus in his estimation. If you remember Festus, he is new to Jerusalem. He didn't see all the events take place. He comes in after Felix. He's missed all of it. And so he thinks Paul is mad because he doesn't know what's happened in Jerusalem. Festus has no frame of reference. So in a sense, Paul kind of speaks past him and he says, the king knows. The king knows. They happen. There's true events, and Agrippa knows it. Now see, Paul's witness in all of this. He asks Agrippa, he says, do you believe the prophets? You've seen everything that's happened in Jerusalem. Do you believe the prophets? So look at Paul's witness here. He witnesses rationally. He witnesses experientially when he gives his testimony. And now Paul reasons biblically in asking about the prophets. We can see his witness here. Paul says, I was once like you. That's rational reasoning. Paul says, this is why I changed. This is my testimony. That's experiential reasoning. Paul says, do you believe the prophets? Biblical reasoning as a witness. All three are on display here in this chapter. And in all three of these categories, Paul represents his past, his present, and his future well. Very well. It's the summation of his witness, and it's a great example of how ours should be. How well do we represent these categories when we share Christ? And in the end, Festus and Agrippa, they represent two different people who reject the gospel. There are literally two people who reject the gospel, but I want you to see the differences in their background. Festus is a Roman. Festus believed in the gods. He was not an atheist. He believed in the gods, but he believed in the Roman gods. And their gods were tied to success in Roman culture. It was difficult for Festus to understand a suffering God. But that is what Christ did. He suffered. Christianity would fly in the face against the Roman gods of fertility and prosperity and success and power. I shared this recently, but it bears repeating, and this is church history in plain language, and it says this. It says, Christianity is the only major religion to have at its central event the humiliation of its God. Its central event is the humiliation of its God. And a Roman Festus cannot understand, why would you worship a God like that? A worldly man with worldly gods of success and prosperity could never comprehend a suffering, humiliated Christ as Savior. But Christ was mocked. He was beaten. I still hold to the idea today that the prosperity gospel, the modern prosperity gospel, which is no gospel, merely attempts to Romanize Jesus, to make him more palatable for people wanting success and ease and power. Quite honestly, they just changed the name, but it's the same gods, little g. I think we're doing the same thing. And whether modern or people or Romans, without discrimination, worldly men make worldly gods, inside and outside the church, whether they're committed to Christ or not. And we have to be careful. We have to go back to Scripture. So Festus, he has no reference for the suffering and humiliated Christ that was raised to glory as a name above every name. And Festus says, Paul, you're mad. How can you believe in a God like that? But the heartbreaker of this story is Agrippa. Agrippa's the heartbreaker. He knew everything Paul was saying. Notice what happened when Paul asked Agrippa if he believes the prophets. What happens at the end of that chapter? The Bible translations are interesting here, and I do my best to read multiple translations when I read a message. This is Agrippa's response in the ESV. And it says this. Agrippa said to Paul, in a short time would you persuade me to be a Christian? Now the ESV renders Agrippa's response as a question. And the NASB and the King James do not. And I understand the translation difference. The reason is there's no punctuation in the Greek. And so some will render as a question, some will render as a statement. What broke my heart as I was going through this chapter this week was what the New King James said. It says this. Now remember, here it says, in a short time would you persuade me to be a Christian as a question. Look at it as a statement. Then Agrippa said to Paul, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. You almost persuade me to become a Christian. So the NASB and the King James render this as a statement, not a question. And as I read these words, I almost jumped off the page at me. What heartbreaking words in Scripture. The almost Christian. The almost saved. The almost believed. Almost. Almost. Notice Agrippa never answers Paul's question about the prophets. He ends the trial and declares Paul innocent. Agrippa knows the prophets, but Agrippa doesn't want to change. It's easier to avoid the question than answer it. It's easier to stay who we are than become a Paul. And I think that is our problem. Man, true Christianity will make radical change. I'm sorry. True Christianity doesn't make minor changes in your life. It makes radical changes. It does. And here's the thing. It is easier to stay the way that we are. It is easier not to address the sin in our life. It is so much easier than taking the big steps. Paul goes from exalted Pharisee to believer in chains. That is a big difference. It's an incredibly big difference. And so in all of this, Paul looks at them and he says, I want all of you to be just like me, except the chains. And I'm sure for a fact he probably held his hands up and let them hear what they had done to him because of the gospel. You see, at the end of Acts 26, we must understand the lessons from the rejection of Festus and Agrippa of the gospel. So let's talk about the worldly rejection. I promise I'm almost done. Stay with me. Worldly people with worldly ideas will never accept the gospel, and that should have no bearing on our faith. Someone makes fun of you, if someone challenges your faith, ridicules you because of your faith, it shouldn't matter. Because ultimately this, worldly opinions and philosophies have no weight on Christ's revelation. You're not going to reason your way to faith. You're not going to reason your way. Christ will reveal himself to you. And then ultimately, Paul considers the world under the grip of Satan. Yet even in chains, Paul considers himself within the arms of Jesus. He understands that the worldly judgment is going to be different than Christ's judgment. And worldly people will not see heavenly things, not without God's help. Then the religious rejection. This is Agrippa's rejection. Man, religious people, those who exalt themselves spiritually, cannot exalt themselves and Christ at the same time. Paul's looking at them and saying, you're going to have to choose. One or the other. You will not exalt yourself in Christ at the same time. It doesn't matter how religious you are. And people who consider themselves good will never believe that their lives depend on the goodness of God. Do you see? Because Paul no longer considered himself enlightened. He is now illuminated by Christ alone. And as we consider this scene today, my question is this, whether Paul, Festus, or Agrippa, who are you most like? And the question I most desperately want you to answer, Are you the almost Christian? Are you the almost Christian? I am not your judge. I'm your pastor. And what I care the most about is you knowing Christ. Are you caught in worldly ideas and there's no way the gospel is going to interrupt your plans? Paul's testimony on the road today suggests greatly that God will interrupt our plans for His if we truly respond. Does human reasoning keep you from godly revelation? Are we trying to make a Roman Jesus that is like Roman gods who give people what they want if they live the right way? Are we almost Christian? Do we sit in church week in and week out, knowing the truth but never actually allowing it to change us? Do we run from difficult truths and the callings from the gospel? Are we almost Christian? But on the other side of this, are we like Paul? Are we willing to share the gospel? Can we? Even if it cost us something, would we accept the chains for the sake of truth? Or is this a gospel of convenience? Of the three in the story today, who would you be? Would you be Festus? Would you be Agrippa? Or would you be Paul? And if you're not sure, if you know who it is, but you're not sure, you like your answer, are you okay with it? Don't let another day pass without knowing the condition of your heart towards God. Understand the witness given to us today. Understand the examples given to us today. I beg you, don't live almost Christian, please. The reason why we're going to pray for the next 2 months, the reason why we're going to focus on what it means to be a worshiper in the next 2 months, I don't want anyone to die without Christ, especially the people I love. Will you pray with me? God, I know today was a longer lesson and we had a lot to cover today. But God, never let us settle for almost. God, never let us settle for just enough. God, what I pray right now for every person here as we get ready for communion, God, that we would remember the body and the blood shed. God, that we could be free. Paul says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. God, teach us how to imitate your Son. Lord, let almost be gone from our vocabulary. Lord, we love and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take a minute. I'll be really quick. Take a minute, pray, and get ready for communion. Thank you. Thank you. Then he took the cup. He said, "This is the blood of my covenant poured out for you. As often as you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." Let's take it together. Will you stand with us? As a kingdom of priests, let's declare this together. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make
his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen. You guys have a great weekend.